Good evening and welcome to a new edition of To The Point. We hear so much of credit rating regarding Egypt. It has been up, it has been down, the dollar has gone up, and now it's going down, what have you. And the question that really raises itself is, where is the Egyptian economy heading? This evening with a credit rating expert, we'll be shedding light on where are we going and are we on the right track. With us this evening is Dr. Amr Hassanein, credit rating expert, amongst other things. A pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you.
Generally speaking, before we go into specific details, where do you think we're heading? Are we on the right track? Are we not on the right track? Are we close to the track? Where are we? Where do we stand?
I think we are on a track. We are on a track. We're trying very hard. We are trying, number one, to recognize what our problems are, and number two, to put solutions for them. I cannot say that we have put all the solutions, not yet, but at least my feeling is, no, there is a reasonable level of recognition of what the problems are. And that is a prerequisite before you can really delve into the solutions.
Can you tell us, when you say recognize the problems, what kind of problems have we recognized over the past 2-3 years, for example? I'm talking about 2-3 years since President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi took over.
Yes,
because this
yes.
is the consistency here.
Yes, yes. First of all, we have to realize that indeed Egypt's positioning worldwide is not that great. I mean, we have to realize that. And the president himself came out and, you know, talked about this in a very transparent way several times.
Yes.
So, number one, we do realize that we have a lot of problems, that our positioning, that our rating worldwide is not that good. So this is number one. Number two, when we talk about recognizing the problems, Egypt's major problem appears on the surface to be economic. But that is not the underlying fact. We need to go a little bit beneath what is on the surface.
Okay.
Egypt's major problem, really, in our view, is institutional, more than economic.
Which is affecting the economy and other things.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. When you look at how Egypt's rating is done, Egypt is divided into four pillars. The economic strength, institutional strength, financial or fiscal strength, and susceptibility to risk. Egypt, surprisingly, economic-wise, is not bad.
Okay.
Our ranking, economic-wise, is not bad. We are in the moderate range. We're not in the low or very low. We are in the moderate range.
Okay.
And I can just give you a few figures, you know. According to last year's figures, this fiscal year still, before the devaluation, I'm sure that after the devaluation, the government will be producing new figures. Egypt's GDP was $334 billion. If you look at some of the other countries, I mean Kuwait, for example, who helps Egypt and gives Egypt financial aid, is $109 billion. Saudi Arabia, great Saudi Arabia, $650 billion. But mind you, I mean, Egypt is $334 billion, Saudi Arabia is $640 billion, but Egypt's economy is diversified, deep and diversified. Saudi Arabia's economy is 98% or 97% oil.
Which is quite risky.
Which is very risky. UAE, $375 billion. Qatar, $159 billion. Tunis, $42 billion. You see, I mean, there is a very, very wide margin. I want to add something to you. The $334 billion, and again, I emphasize this was before the devaluation, really this is the formal economy. The true economy of Egypt is a multiple of that. Because as we always say, the informal economy accounts for maybe 30 to 60% of the
total
economy.
And we witnessed that during the revolution.
Exactly. So if you will treat Egypt fairly in terms of the true GDP, I think the round figure could be double that. Could be double that.
Okay.
And mind you, all of Egypt's economic indicators revolve around the GDP. So you divide the debt by the GDP, you divide the revenue by the GDP, you divide the interest by the GDP.
So our rating should be higher if it includes the informal economy.
But why is the informal economy not included? That's a very important question, because it hits right into the second pillar, which is the institutional strength. So I said economic strength, Egypt is not bad. Okay. Institutional strength, no, Egypt is very low. And that is where our problem is. This is our biggest problem, and this is, Egypt is very low in that, and this is what is hitting into the fiscal strength, making it very, very low.
Why, if I'm in the informal sector, why would I formalize myself when I have the benefit of not paying taxes, for example? Because this is what happens with the informal.
Thank you. You're raising...
Why should I pay the tax?
Thank you. You're raising some very important questions. When we talk about institutional strength, and this is the main point that I would like to harp on, I'm talking about governance. I'm talking about two major issues there: rule of law and corruption, and accordingly, government effectiveness, the ability of the institutions of the country to deliver. Your institutions in this country, unfortunately, are very weak, very weak. The rule of law, Egypt, unfortunately, is quite low on that. Corruption index is very high in Egypt. These are two major components of the institutional strength, and they hit right into the question that you are asking, rule of law. If the rule of law was proper, informal sector would be registering. If corruption was not there, informal sector would be registering. Okay, so these are two extremely important factors, rule of law and corruption, and which directly affect the government effectiveness, the institutions of the country. How are they able to fulfill their social contract with the people, and how are they able to deliver what they should be delivering to the public? That is our major concern. And in my opinion, or in our analysis as credit rating, this is the underlying major problem in Egypt as a country. And this is what is pulling down the economy.
And this is also what's pulling down the rating?
Absolutely.
Or how is the rating done? Standard and Poor's and what have
the rating,
what
as
are
I
the
said,
criteria?
As I said, one, economic strength. Egypt is moderate there. Two, institutional strength. Egypt is low there, and that is a major one. Fiscal strength, Egypt is very low there, and susceptibility to risk, Egypt is very high there. So these are the four pillars which together, and of course I can tell you that there are many, many calculations and many numbers, but these are the four underlying pillars. These are the four major pillars.
When you say fiscal strength and we're weak there, what do you mean by weak? Why are we weak? Because you explained the economic and you explained somewhat the institutions.
Because our financing needs are very high and we are unable to generate them. We have a large population. That large population needs a lot of infrastructure. It needs a lot of services. It needs so many things. Our financing needs, we need to finance all of this. Our financing needs are very high compared to our ability to service those needs. Okay. That is the fiscal.
So we need a lot of money, which we don't have.
Exactly.
To explain it to the average layman. So we need to generate, we need to produce, generate money to address the fiscal strength, so to speak.
Exactly. And in my opinion, and in the opinion of the credit rating analysis process, it is the institutional strength that carries the burden there. If the institutions are strong enough, if the rule of law is properly maintained, and this is a subject that we need to talk about, if the corruption is handled properly, we should be able very easily. Egypt is known to be to have what we call a deep economy and a diversified economy. And these are the two aspects that are mainly needed in order to have a thriving and a strong economy. If we are able to deal with the rule of law issue and with the corruption issue, and I think we can handle them, the government effectiveness will increase, and therefore all of the other symptoms will start to soften down.
Institutions, what needs to be done in our institutions?
Institutions currently have a problem. Mm. Number one, corruption. Mm. We are lucky that the government recognizes that very well. Mm. The president came out and talked about it clearly and specifically.
He made it very, very clear that we have a battle with corruption.
Exactly, very clear. He is also directing the control authorities to embolden them, to become emboldened. This is happening, okay? Hmm. However, we have a problem.
Yes.
Corruption causes a huge amount of seepage from the many benefits and the projects that are being done.
It wastes resources.
There's a huge amount of seepage there.
Yes.
Seepage of our economy. Mm. until now, I would love to see a comprehensive plan to deal with corruption. That is important. We need to define corruption into an actions corruption abatement. We need to deal with corruption abatement. And I think the political will is there. We need to talk about pre and post, pre-corruption and post-corruption. By pre-corruption, we mean deterrence. You need to have some deterrence mechanisms in place in order to deter employees from becoming corrupt. Mm. And at the same time, you need to have the post mechanisms in place to deal with the issues when they happen. However, I would love to see a comprehensive plan. Mm. A comprehensive plan, we have the plan of the country, 2030. And yes, it talks about the importance of dealing with corruption, but I do not believe that there has been a national plan how we will approach the problem. Mm. I can assure you that if the issue is dealt with diligently and consistently, Egypt's corruption index will vary significantly. The rule of law at the same time, and we'll talk about that, will vary significantly. Then we will see investors coming in.
Mm. Rule of law.
Rule of law.
We have a lot of laws.
Yes, and that is a problem, by the way. Mm. I'm not sure that we need too many more laws. Mm. Rule of law, we have a serious problem there. Mm. We have a very serious problem. Mm. And again, the interesting thing is there has always been awareness of these problems. Mm. What happens is, right now, public employees and public officials feel very constrained in their decision-making process. Why? The laws are not clear. The laws need more clarity. Mm. The laws need to identify clearly between what is a criminal act that will subject a public employee to criminal prosecution versus what is an administrative error or administrative mistake that would simply subject the employee to, you know, maybe some kind of reprimanding, some kind of negative evaluation or something like that, or even going up to firing him from his job and replacing him by another employee if the judgment was not good enough. Hmm. Okay? Hmm. Our laws, unfortunately, are not clear in this aspect.
The loopholes or not clear at all?
Not clear. Not clear.
Okay.
They have articles that can be interpreted either way. Mm. And that is very, very unhealthy. Very unhealthy. Mm. What is the result? We've seen the result. The government apparatus is almost in a state of paralysis. Almost in a state of paralysis. Mm. Decision makers shy away from making the decisions. Why? Whenever you talk to them, they are concerned. I mean, how many ministers have gone into jail, huh? And public officials have gone to jail, and 90% or 95% of them, after 2 or 3 years, they were told, sorry, we made a mistake. Hmm. You are innocent. Hmm. Well, how many?
Well, cases were filed against them, and it had to be investigated,
exactly,
unfortunately.
Exactly. But how many employees are willing to risk staying in jail for 2 or 3 years to be told at the end?
Not many. Definitely not.
The result is employees are shying from taking decisions, and the result is you have a public apparatus that is really crippled today. Hmm. And we'll continue to do that until we address this problem and until we deal with it. Look at the bright side. Can we deal with this? Of course we can deal with this. Of course we can deal with it. Can we deal with corruption? If there is a public agreement, a social contract and a public agreement that we shall deal with it, we will be able to deal with it. There is no doubt that if these two indices are bettered, if they are dealt with, the face of Egypt, Egypt will have a facelift, a face uplift. Egypt will become a different place for investors to come in. When we talk about the rule of law, we're really talking about the full justice system, the full scope of the justice system. This needs to be upgraded. And there is clear recognition from the judicial people, from the administration, there is a clear recognition that this needs to be addressed. If this is properly addressed, you see, an investor comes and he faces corruption, he faces bureaucracy, and bureaucracy, take care, bureaucracy could be another face of corruption. Where does he go to save him? He needs to go to the justice system to protect him from these two. If the justice system does not protect him, then he feels very, very insecure regarding his investment. Once we deal with these issues, I can assure you, this is when investors will stand in a line ready to come here. Egypt is one of the best countries in the region to receive investors, but we have to deal with this.
So when people say that the investment law will be encouraging investors, this is not really going to do the job. It's a part, but not really going to do the job. Because we're bargaining a lot on the investment law that once this is out, it's in place, it's applied, the investor will start running.
In my opinion, the investment law accounts for 5%, not more than 5%. Okay, fine. To be more generous, 8%, but not more than that. It is the full justice system apparatus that we have to deal with. It is the maze of laws, rules, and regulations. It is the corruption. These are the issues that we have to deal with. And lucky for us, we know the issues now. We know the issues. All we have to do is deal with them.
How can you have a comprehensive national plan to combat corruption? And I'm talking this because really it's something, it exists everywhere, all over the world.
Absolutely.
But maybe nowadays we see it more so than ever, even in Egypt. How can we combat such a phenomenon?
People have thought of this and have studied it and have developed mechanisms. Let's start from the very beginning. Number one, employees who work in the government sector or in the public sector, just like employees in the private sector, do they take ethics training? Do they take regular, and I mean regular, courses to that define for them clearly every year what is a bribe, what are the consequences of taking a bribe, how you should behave?
There is a big campaign now on bribing, especially lots of arrests right now.
We would like. You see, okay, you're talking about lots of arrests. That is what I call post. I'm talking about deterrence. Deterrence.
Yes, I understand.
I would argue that by having these training and these regular ethics training as part of the employees' jobs, you will eliminate at least 50 or 60% of at least the petty corruption that is happening. Can you imagine Egypt with 50 or 60% of the corruption disappearing? Can you imagine what this country will look like? Can you imagine what our lives will look like? Take care that the petty corruption affects not only high-level business people, but affects the normal citizen, the ordinary citizen.
The day-to-day running of your life
exactly.
is affected by this.
And people feel very angry and very frustrated. Can you imagine the social and the political impact of this anger and frustration? If this is dealt with, you are really covering a huge amount of territory. This is just one example. Another example, worldwide employees are required, by the way, this is private and public, are required to sign every year on conflict of interest issues, whether they have a relationship with people for whom they are doing services, anything like that. This is part of internal audit procedures. Employees are required to do that every year. Now, why can't we have something like this? If you think of these are almost costless steps. They cost nothing, but they make the employees always at a heightened level of feeling where they are going and why they should not go there. If you just leave the employees without reminding them every year with these issues, well,
they you get used to just fitting into the system.
And it becomes part of their daily lives. When you do these steps, employees become at a heightened level of awareness and they are careful to try to avoid these things. This is what we call deterrence, and deterrence always makes you live with 50 or 60% out of that corruption state. These are just examples.
If I take the other side and say, have we introduced to the potential investor, where do we need the investment?
Could you elaborate on the question?
What I mean is, what sectors do we need investment in? What kind of investment do we need? Do we need someone to come and stay, build shop? Do we need training? Do we need financing? What do we need?
Okay. I do not think that in Egypt we have thought that well of what we need versus what we do not need. We have only thought, or not only, but we have thought mainly of what is available or what could be available. We haven't thought of our needs that much. Do we need labor-intensive investments because we may need more to create more jobs? Or do we
need, I'd say we do.
Exactly. You see, this is what we haven't been able to articulate well, and I guess it needs to be articulated. It needs to be articulated. But I want to tell you something. If we provide a good and an incentivized investment climate, investors will come and they will discover for themselves what is best to do in this country. I would argue that. And when we talk about that, we just talked about corruption. I would like to see a lot of work done in the rule of law issue. I would like a lot of work to be done in the justice system and the administration of justice system, and accordingly in the effectiveness of government institutions.
What about the political environment, the regional political environment? You don't think this is affecting investment? Because you see, we're part and parcel of a region, and Egypt is surrounded really by boiling points.
Yes,
this is not dragging the investor away.
There is no doubt about that, but Egypt really has been quite stable and has demonstrated stability, and the underlying factors of instability
around us
are not really here. I mean, to be honest about it, and to be fair to the country, yes, susceptibility to risk is high, but the underlying factors, which, I mean, okay, Egypt went through a revolution, two revolutions, just like Libya went through a revolution, just like Yemen went through, just like Syria went through a revolution, but the underlying factors that led to what's happening in these countries do not exist in Egypt. So I mean, I wouldn't be too harsh and say that this would be a driving away factor that would drive away investors.
When you say susceptibility, high susceptibility to risk, is that not interpreted into high profit margin as well?
That is
the
correct.
More you take the risk, the more you, I'm not an economist, but
No. You're absolutely
isn't
right.
Isn't that how it's done? The more risk, the more profit?
You are absolutely right. You are absolutely right. And it is true that most multinationals that come to Egypt exhibit rates of return that are among the highest in the world in their operations worldwide. Why is this?
Why?
Egypt poses quite a bit of risk for them. And by risk here, I mean the economic risk factors. Easy entry, easy exit should be one of the factors. We do not have an easy entry, easy exit. Bureaucracy poses a very high risk, and dealing with the justice system poses a high risk. Corruption poses a high risk. With all these risks, if somebody has been able to circumvent these risks and deal with them, they are making very high rates of return. Why? Because others are unable to come into the market and compete with them on a very competitive basis. And this is why their rates of return become very high. And it is true. They make very high rates of return. That is a very correct factor.
We have a problem with the dollar. It was going up, went all the way up to 20 pounds per dollar.
Yes.
It started decreasing, stabilized for a while at 18, and a few days ago it even hit the 15 plus mark.
Yes.
And then it started to rise again.
Yes.
Why? Even though predictions are the dollar will drop.
Yes. Well, there are definitely several factors. Okay, there are definitely several factors. First of all, I myself am concerned about this gyration. It's a very wide amplitude, okay? Had the drop been little by little over a month or 2 months...
No, it's in a week.
It was in 1 week a drop.
A huge drop.
Whenever we see something like this, we get a bit concerned, okay?
Why?
Is this due to market dynamics, to true market dynamics? And what were the market dynamics behind it? And what are the fundamentals that are behind this? What could the fundamentals be? Have we seen an influx of investment or FDIs into the country? Not much. Have we seen an influx of tourism? Not much. We've seen some increase in workers' remittances. Have we seen an increase in Suez Canal? Not much. Among the factors that contribute to that is the lowered consumption levels, the lowered import levels. That has contributed to this. But I guess we just have to wait and see what will happen in the future. It is very difficult to predict. As a matter of fact, if we are in a proper market, then any prediction should be wrong. If we are in a proper market. A proper market means that you cannot predict.
Okay.
That is the meaning of a proper
even
market.
Even though all financial experts, official and unofficial, are predicting.
The definition of a proper market is that you should not be able to predict.
What is will happen to your currency?
Absolutely.
Why?
What will happen to the currency, or what will happen to your stock exchange?
Why can't we predict?
That is the definition of a market. You know why? You know why? There is a reason for that.
Why?
If we predict that, let's talk about a certain stock, and the same thing applies for the currency. If we say we are predicting that that stock will go up tomorrow, what do you think will happen? Everybody will run to buy that stock.
So you're influencing it and it will...
So it will not go up, okay? Or everybody will sell it, okay, so the price will go down. So what I'm trying to say is that any prediction will generate an action today that would abort the prediction.
Okay.
Any prediction.
So when we predicted a drop in the value of the dollar, this aided in the upping of the dollar again.
It could be. Mm-hmm. Any prediction will generate an action that would abort the prediction right away. These are market fundamentals. Market fundamentals. If we have a properly functioning market, or what we call an efficient market. If people are able to predict and the prediction happens as they predicted, it means that you are not living in a properly functioning market. Point blank.
We have the potential is the new generation. How can we incorporate or fit the new generation into our economic cycle in a constructive fashion? In other words, we want them, because the institution, they will be entrusted with institutions in the future. We don't want them to carry on a corruption thing. Yes. We want them to work on strengthening our economy. How can we incorporate the future generation in an efficient manner?
I will cite two things. Justice and education. One, they have to be educated. Two, they have to rest assured that there is a proper justice system around them. Without these two, we are just throwing them into some kind of abyss that is not healthy. Justice and education. And mind you, if you will put my back to the wall and tell me choose between justice and education, I would hate to choose between them. But if you put my back to the wall and tell me to choose among them, I will choose justice first.
Before educate.
Absolutely.
Even though to even execute proper justice, you need people to be well educated.
That is correct, but there is a problem. You may be able to live in an uneducated society for a short while, but imagine a society without justice.
Okay, point understood.
When you talk about justice, when you talk about the definition of a state, what is the definition of a state? How do you define a country, a state? A state is a contiguous piece of land that has clearly defined borders, that has people living on it, and that has a proper rules, regulations that they've agreed upon to be governed by it. This is definition. Remove any part of that definition and you do not have a state anymore.
What about labor? Because we're always, people are always saying that we have a problem. We have quite a large number of labor and potential labor.
Yes.
But we have a problem with the quality of the labor.
Yes.
And unfortunately, it seems we're waiting for the government to train. The private sector's contribution in that cycle or in that sphere is quite minimal.
I really am not sure about that. I think the private sector tries to train the people and works hard on training them because it is in his best interest. I mean when Adam Smith developed the theory, the famous theory of capital markets and capitalism, I mean, the theory is still working. Leave the people to do what is in their best interest, and in doing so, they will serve society so much better than if you tell them what to do. And they are doing, they are working on training the people. There is no doubt about that. But you see, as I said, you need to rebuild the citizen. You know something? With all our various perceptions about Donald Trump, but there is a term that he has been using, or his administration has been using recently, and I like the term very much. Deconstruction of the state. He wants to, this is what he wants to apply there in the US, deconstruction of the state.
Meaning
taking
the state apart
and rebuilding it. Okay?
To reformat it,
exactly. I believe we need this here. With whatever we agree or disagree with him, but we need this. This is what we need here. The deep state, we really need to work on deconstructing it. I need every worker and every citizen to know, number one, that they will receive a reasonable education. Number two, that they will get a fair chance in life. Do you know if people get convinced that they will receive a fair chance in life, their attitude towards life will become very different. Very different. And they will be able to achieve beyond what you think. You are unleashing a huge human potential. That is not unleashed until this minute. Whether for a government employee, do you believe that the government employees, their real potential is unleashed? No. I believe the government employees are working with a max of 20% of their true capacity. Yes. So are the workers and the citizens. If you make people feel that they have a proper chance, a fair chance, a proper justice system around them with a reasonable education system, you are unleashing a huge potential in this country.
One of the things that when one looks at economies is concerned about, when we hear a country like Saudi Arabia, and you said it has $650 billion in GDP.
Yes.
Yet there are articles today that we're talking about a reduction in the raising the fuel prices. In other words, a reduction in the fuel prices, and that they will have to start even cutting bit by bit the subsidy.
Yes.
Saudi Arabia.
Yes, Saudi Arabia. Yes, I told you. I mean, the when I said that the GDP of Saudi Arabia is double that of Egypt. However, I preface that by saying that. Take care, this is a one-dimensional economy.
And Kuwait is doing the same thing, starting to cut on subsidies.
Absolutely.
But these are the rich countries.
These are the rich guys.
So what's happening?
Well,
if they're having difficulties.
It's a troubled region. No, nobody said it's not a troubled region. It is a troubled region, and we have to admit that, and we have to deal with it.
Hmm.
However, again, can we make money in this country?
Hmm.
Can we make money in this country?
Can we?
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely.
Why should an investor come? Because some people are watching us and they're wondering what's attractive about investing in Egypt.
If we are able to deal with the issues that we talked about, investors will come.
Why should they?
Why should they come? They will find a much, much lower level of corruption. They will find a country that is governed properly by rule of law. They will find government employees that are supportive, that are not afraid to take decisions. They will find a stable country, a reasonably stable country. They will find a country with lots of resources. Why would they not come if they find
big market?
A very big market, a deep and diversified economy, as we said. Why would they not come?
Hmm.
But we have to deal with these issues. Egypt's underlying problem is not economic, it is institutional.
The fact that we have a very diversified economy, does this qualify us to be export-oriented rather than import-oriented? Because unfortunately, over the past few years, we have become very much import-oriented and we forgot this export issue.
Yes.
Can we go back to being really export-oriented, more than import-oriented?
We have to. We have no other choice.
Because we killed a lot of industries,
We have no other choice. We have no other choice. If we remain import-oriented and with the decline in foreign currency coming to us, we will be dead. No, we cannot afford to do that. However, let me tell you something. Have we proven to ourselves over the past period that we can live with much less imports than what we did before?
We did over the past year.
We proved it to ourselves over the past 2 months.
Yes, and we started substituting the foreign manufactured product with the locally manufactured product.
In a couple of months, we will be hitting Ramadan.
Mm.
Can we prove to ourselves that we can go through Ramadan with much less imports than what we used to do before? I think we need to prove that to ourselves.
Hmm.
The next step immediately is to depend on local imports, on local products. The following step is to sell these local products outside.
Hmm.
That is the following step immediately.
What message would you be directing to the future Egyptian generation? Because it is standing watchful, unfortunately. It's a mix between fortunate and unfortunate that the young generation it's a fast-paced generation. It wants things to happen very fast. They're impatient.
Yes, and they have a right to be impatient. I mean, the world is a fast-running world.
Mm.
What I would tell them is stand up for your rights.
Mm.
You have a right to good education. Demand it.
Hmm.
Do not acquiesce with corruption. Do not acquiesce with cheating. Cheating is a part of corruption inside the education system. Do not acquiesce with that. Know that if you have a proper and a good education, you will be able to make it in the end. So stand up for your rights, demand a good education and fight for it, demand a fair chance through a proper application of rule of law and through a proper justice system, demand those two and you will make it.
What message would you be directing to Egyptians living abroad? Because at the end of the day, this is their country. And we need more involvement by Egyptian expats.
Yes, we do need more involvement, there is no doubt. But you know something? I've lived abroad for a while, and I can tell you that people who live abroad, always part of their heart is with their home country. Out of experience.
Definitely.
I've lived it, I've known it. And by the way, there is something very interesting in today's world. With the very, very strong communication means, your tying with your home country is even much stronger.
Definitely.
There is no doubt about that. I think we need to give them the chance to contribute. We need to give them the fair chance, as I said, to be active participants. And we need to involve them seriously and genuinely.
Unfortunately, our time is up. Dr. Amr Hassanein, credit rating expert, thank you very much for your fruitful input. Indeed, we have problems, but there is always light at the end of the tunnel so long as we roll up our sleeves and, number one, fight corruption. And this is the responsibility of each and every individual citizen, I believe. Thank you very much for your fruitful input. I'd like to thank you, the viewers. We'll see you same time next week. Until then, good night.